I would thank the. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to speak on something, and it turned out to be renal replacement catheters. And I think the House of God statement of placement comes first is quite important. I sometimes speak to doctors in training about renal replacement therapy, and I, after talking to them a shorter, longer time, I end up with the conclusion that essentially you have to do two things. Fill out the prescription form, which a primary school pupil can probably do if they just know how, what the patient weighs and things like that. And the other thing is a bit more difficult, have a functioning dialysis catheter, which could be tricky. Speaking of this subject, there were a few random thoughts that came into my mind, and as you see the placement of these, there is sometimes a bit of chaos in my mind. But infection of the catheter-related infection seems to be important, and downtime when the machine is not running seems to be important when placing a catheter. Direct drug clearance, that is what you infuse in your in any catheter, disappears in the machine, is kind of a good idea to consider. Long-term complications such as vessel stenosis could be something, and thrombosis. And I thought I would speak about these subjects, but first to the catheter. So usually it's a double lumen catheter, and it's as thick as a pen. Usually you need a quite large bore catheter. And with the evolution of catheters from the early days, the catheters seem to have more, mostly lumen nowadays and no wall, which is a kind of good thing. The materials have also got better. Nowadays, many catheters are in polyurethane, which is quite hard outside the patient in room temperature and becomes very soft in the patient. The alternative is a silicone catheter, which is also a good choice. And how the catheter tip should look like, whether it should be straight or fenestrated on the side, it's more or less a matter of choice. Either you have problems with insertions, or you may run into problems with insertion. Alternatively, you can have a bit more turbulence leading to a higher risk of filter clotting. But if you, and all this is expert opinions and people thinking that these all these are good ideas. Regarding insertions of the catheter, as long as you have quite clean hands or gloves and use a sterile technique according to the state of the art and use ultrasound, I think things go quite well. So what about downtime? Downtime is when the machine is not running. Now, as you probably know very well, the method we use in the ICU is called continuous renal replacement therapy, which means that it should be just continuous. As you see, it's a very inefficient way of solute clearance in the when you look at it by the minute compared to intermittent hemodialysis. But if you let it run 24/7 or 24/3 or whatever, how many days you do, it becomes very efficient. But unlike intermittent hemodialysis, you cannot do another half an hour of dialysis because you already run it for 24 hours. What you can do is probably increase the dose. So having your machine on seems to be quite important. And what are the reasons of the machine standing still? Well, first of all, if you look at in studies, it's usually 1 to 2 hours a day when the machine is not running. And the main reason, 2009, in a French study with quite some intermittent hemodialysis patients, by the way, was circuit clotting. That was the main bulk. The second most common reason for the machine not working was catheter problems. And the third was clinical reasons. Patient has to go to the theater or do some investigation in the radiology department or something like that. Now, we have had this situation in our units in 2006, for example, when we used no anticoagulation whatsoever. It was a very interesting time. And then we started to use quite good anticoagulation. And all of a sudden, the problems disappeared with clotting. And what do you have left? Well, nowadays, the largest bulk of problems come from the catheters. So it's kind of really important to have a good dialysis catheter. And I have told you that the catheters are quite standard. So we get into this situation when a father talks to his son and says that it's not what you have, it's where you put it. And you have to consider putting your catheter in a large vessel. The large vessel is the caval vein. Superior, inferior, and then some people think it's wise to put it in the right atrium. But once again, these are expert opinions. Everybody thinks stuff, but no one has really investigated this really well. Now, if you are to come down, and this is physics, you don't need a randomized controlled trial for that. If you want to come down in the superior caval vein from the right side, you will need a catheter which is somewhere between 12 and 15 centimeters on a normal size patient. From the left side, it's a bit further. The tricky thing is the femoral vein, because you would preferably want the tip in the inferior caval vein. So you need a quite long catheter. We tend to use 24 centimeters. Now, the question is, does this matter at all? These are two studies, one from the US, 2008. It's a prospective study comparing neck or groin placement of dialysis catheters, and they found that femoral localization of the catheter meant a almost six times risk of the CRRT machine stopping due to catheter problems. Now, there is a French randomized controlled trial, which I'm going to present in different sections, also looking at this, and those of you not having, how should I say, supranormal visus, I can tell you that these are the femoral patients, and these are the jugular catheter group patients randomized to those groups. There's absolutely no difference whatsoever in the downtime between these two groups. What's the difference between these studies? Well, the French tended to use 24 centimeter catheters, that is putting the tip in the inferior caval vein. So placement is quite important for the machine to run. What about infection? If you say that you put a line in the groin, people say, oh no, it's so filthy there, don't do that. And on the other hand, you know that patients who are coughing and all kinds of gastric contents running out of their mouth over the neckline could also pose a problem. So how does this work? These are three studies on central lines, not dialysis catheters. But the first study from the US showed that patients who had a central line in the groin or in the neck, up to 5 days, there was no difference in colonization or clinical infection whatsoever. Another study with a much larger group of patients, where the lines were in place for 9 days, it was much more common with colonization of the catheter in the groin compared to the neck. And surprise, surprise, there were much more gram-positive cultures from the neck catheters, and there were much more gram-negative cultures from the groin. And the third study comparing the subclavian localization, which is considered to be the neatest or cleanest place to have a catheter comparing to the groin, they saw some more colonization in the groin, but not on the neck. Yet, none of these studies showed a greater catheter infection rate in the femoral vein. We are back. So, what about dialysis catheters? There is a very nice study from Parienti, who seems to do much of the randomized control trials in this area. And here we have time of catheterization. And this is catheters free of colonization on removal. So, at 5 days, you see that half of the patients have removed their catheters, or probably they didn't, but the nurses did, And the rate of colonization was the same between femoral and jugular placement. So there's really no difference here. At 10 days, still no difference. Now, they also looked at how, if it matters how you look. And it probably does matter, although this is a subgroup analysis, but these are the skinny ones, and these are the more chubby patients, and these are the mid-group. And the skinny ones, well, the skinny ones seem to do better with a femoral line than a neckline in terms of infections. It's a subgroup analysis, so it may not be true, but that's the way it looks. The mid patients, it didn't matter, and if you had, if you have a BMI over 28, that's still not your abdomen hanging down, but I should imagine that if you have skin over your catheter, or in a hamburger fashion, then you ran into troubles, and infection would be more common. So, in a sense, infection, if you remove your catheter within 5 days, I think you're quite safe to have it in the femoral location if you cannot have it in your neck. What about thrombosis? Now, we come back to the house of God situation here, because if you don't take a temperature, you can't find a fever. So thrombosis is very unusual, very uncommon in ICU. But if you look for it, it's actually quite common. So if you do ultrasound around femoral lines, you will find some 20% thrombosis, which is pretty common. If you do phlebography, you should find the same thing. The phlebography study by Derbeck was done in the era when thrombosis prophylaxis wasn't that common. And what he found was that you had thrombosis also on the other side where you didn't have a catheter. So we are quite confused there. But when it comes to symptomatic thromboembolic events, they are very, very uncommon. We looked at those in the unit I worked in at that time, and it was really as uncommon as thromboembolic events in the patients without catheters at all. So it comes down to a few percent. What does this mean? This means that if you read any study on thromboembolic events on catheters, they are going to be underpowered. It's a very unlikely event. And probably it doesn't matter to have your line but in the groin or the neck, but we don't know. So what about drug direct drug clearance? We tend to believe that it's good to give drugs to the patient. That's why we do it. Now, if you have your dialysis catheter close to your central line, your drugs could end up in the bin. That's what you think, or it probably doesn't matter, or how is it? Well, there's a recommendation that the catheters should be at least 2 centimeters apart. How you would know that, it's difficult to say, because whether you put your line from the subclavian insertion point or from the neck waist, they will all end up in the same location, the tips. And that's where drugs are administered, if you administer them through a central line. So we did a study in pigs. And we either put the dialysis catheter in the neck or through the femoral vein. And then we had a central line, and either the tip was very close to the dialysis catheter, or it was on the other side of the right atrium. And what we did was we titrated the blood pressure to 50 mean arterial pressure, and then we used noradrenaline to increase it, and then we gave a short infusion of gentamicin. And what you can see is that the noradrenaline dose was, you needed double as much noradrenaline to keep the same blood pressure in these pigs if the drug was administered close to the dialysis catheter compared to if it went into the inferior caval vein. And also, because noradrenaline doesn't really matter, you give more and you target the blood pressure. But your gentamicin doses needed to be much higher, or your concentrations were much lower if half of it disappeared in the dialysis machine. What about long-term issues? These data are from chronic patients, and it's uncertain whether they have any relevance to ICU patients, but subclavian site, if you use that, there's a higher risk of stenosis, and probably it's wise to avoid it. There are other reasons to avoid the subclavian site for dialysis. You get a lot of downtime problems, too. And the femoral site could be an issue if you get a stenosis. The patients who are going to be transplanted, maybe it's not a good idea to put them there. The transplant surgeons can be angry people. So the question is, my message is you can probably use the femoral site, and when you don't need your catheters, pull them out because you will run into trouble. Now, how are we doing in Sweden? These are patients, 3 years of patients, each line is a patient, and this is the length of CRT hours. So this is from the Swedish ICU registry, and what you see is that the mean dialysis time is 132 hours. Now the question is, how long time did the patients have catheters, and if we look at that, it's roughly 12 hours more. And I think that's a quite reasonable situation that, after all, the risk of the dialysis catheter is partly the insertion and partly the thromboembolic and infectious complications. So if you switch off your machine, remove the catheters, I think you can wait a few hours, like to be sure that you don't have to start it again, but please remove your catheters. In conclusion, continuous renal replacement therapy should be continuous and let the wheels go round and round. And how do you do that? Well, with the right anticoagulation and right catheter in the right vessel, I think you can achieve that. I think you don't have to be very much afraid of the femoral site if you cannot use the right internal jugular vein. And if you put your catheter quite neatly, according to the state of the art, that's good, but please remember to remove them, because colonization and asymptomatic thrombosis are there, and make sure that they don't become clinical problems. And on that note, I thank you for your attention.